read our scriptures this morning. Give me 1 minute. And it's Matthew 9:9-13. And it reads as thus: as Jesus was walking along, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at his tax collector's booth. "Follow me and be my disciple," Jesus said to him. So Matthew got up and followed him. 10, later Matthew invited Jesus and his disciples to his home as dinner guests, along with many tax collectors and other disreputable sinners. But when the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with such scum?" When Jesus heard this, he said, "Healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do." Then he added, "Now go and learn the meaning of the scripture. I want you to show mercy, not offer sacrifices. For I have come to call not those who think they are righteous, but to those who know they are sinners." It's time to change lanes to the faith zone. So the delicate dance between objective facts and subjective opinions is quite amusing. I'm going somewhere, just follow me. While certain matters stand as indisputable facts, others exist purely in the realm of personal viewpoints or perspectives. So here are just a few. I'm going to state the fact and then the opinion. So the fact is, Christianity is a monotheistic religion centered on the life and teaching of Jesus Christ. That's a fact. The opinion is, Christianity has a branding problem. That's an opinion. Another fact is, Christianity is the largest religion in the world with over 2.4 billion followers. That's a fact. The opinion is, Christianity is a dying religion in America. Yes, that's an opinion. Another fact is, you need to eat in order to survive. That's a fact. An opinion is, Mexican, Italian burgers, etc., are best foods. That's an opinion. That's somebody's opinion. A fact is, basketball is a sport. That's a fact. It's a sport. But an opinion is, basketball is the best sport. That's an opinion. So I hope you got the point this morning. Don't get into a habit of confusing fact and opinions. Don't confuse facts and opinions. One of the most dangerous things for a believer is to be more concerned with how he or she feels about something than the facts of God's word. Hallelujah. This morning, God's facts matter more than your feelings. Uh-oh, yes. That's a PSA announcement. God's facts is more than your feelings or my feelings. Because you know why? Feelings are subjective. It's valuated. One moment your feelings are saying one thing, and the next your feelings are saying something different. It sways like the wind. One moment you're in love, and the next you are not. One moment you feel confident, and the next you feel insecure and unassured, because we cannot trust our feelings. We just can't trust it. So let me give you an example. 2 weeks ago, I was driving to a conference, and everywhere I go, pretty much in the city of Atlanta, I turn on Waze because, you know, Waze always got a new way. It's always recommending an alternative route. So this particular day, Waze recommended an alternative route for me. It rerouted me. But this particular day, trusting my own intuition and familiarity with the morning rush hour, I stuck to what I thought was the optimal route for me. Because where Waze was telling me to go, I did not want to go. But as fate would have it, my chosen path was riddled with 2 hours of traffic, while the alternate route bypassed all of the congestion. So needless to say, I ended up over 2 hours late for the conference because I did not heed to the recommended alternative routes. So what I want to impress upon you this morning is that so many have limited their potential because they have operated from a place of opinion, what your feelings told you at the time. If you operate from opinions, you will constantly be under the control of others. Somebody this morning is listening, and I'm going up your street this morning. If you have been led by others, my God, you are underneath their thought capabilities this morning. You will be bound by their words, and you'll be bound by others if that's what you are doing. You're living under somebody else's opinion, not your own, not God's way. I want to implore you that the Lord wants you to have a limitless potential. He's saying all things are possible through me. But when you do it on your own, there'll be limits, there'll be boundaries. But the Lord is saying, come on, no limits, no boundaries. I want you to have limitless potential. You must pursue God's plan, not your opinions. You must pursue God's plans and not your preferences.
Amen.
Hey, glory, glory, glory. For somebody who didn't catch that, you must pursue God's plans and not your opinions, because your opinions change daily. Surely every second of the day, your opinions are changing. Your preferences are changing. So pursue God's plan. Because watch this. The Pharisees had a feeling about Matthew and the tax collectors that wasn't in line with the facts of the word of God. They had their own feelings about them, but it wasn't in line with the facts of the word of God. So the Pharisees' feelings, they had feelings, but Jesus had facts. This morning, just like you have feelings, but Jesus has facts. Jesus quotes to them from the word of God in Matthew 9 and 6. I want you to show love, not offer sacrifices. I want you to know me more than I want burnt offerings. That's what Jesus said. He stated the facts. Jesus uses the word of God. And he said in Psalms 138 and verse 2 in the latter stanza, for thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name. Hallelujah. No wonder Jeremiah the prophet taught that God is always watching to see that his word is fulfilled in Jeremiah 1 and 12. He's watching to make sure that his word is fulfilled. My God. In John 1, hallelujah, 1 through 3, it says, in the beginning, the Word already existed. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He existed in the beginning with God. God created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. The Word gave life to everything that was created, and his life brought light to everyone. It's Jesus who spoke the word. As the word itself decides to use what had already been written as the word of God, what makes you think that your opinion, your word, your validation, your thought can even hold a candle next to the infallible word of God Almighty? Why do you think your opinions, hallelujah, your word, your thoughts, your validation can even hold a candle to the infallible word of God Almighty? Jesus, this morning, it's our expression of power and authority that's in God's word. He's our example this morning of how powerful and how quick his word is in your life. So stop putting more weight on the words of others than what God says. Tell yourself, stop this morning. Stop putting more weight on the words of others than what God says. And I'll even go a step further. Stop the noise in your head and putting weight on the thoughts in your head than what God says. Hallelujah, my God. This used to be a real challenge for me. My insecurity was so in, oh my God, was so reinforced by the criticisms of others. But this morning, I'm telling you to stop putting more weight to the feelings you have more than you do on God's word concerning your life. Hey, hallelujah, my God, my God, my God. Hey, my God, God's word is the highest authority this morning. Not you, not somebody else thinking that they know about you. They're not the author and finisher of your faith. This morning, let God's word be the highest authority in your life, including your own self, because we are self-sabotagers. Oh, my God, for one moment we think that we can do it, and then the next moment something gets in your mind and then you back down. But this morning, a silence, oh my God, that sound in your ear, if it ain't God's sound, hallelujah, silence it in your ear. Stop putting more weight on that feeling that you're feeling, because God's weight, God's word has more authority. If you build your life upon it, you will prosper this morning. If you build your life upon God's word, which is the highest authority, my God, you will be prosperous. If you get behind it and follow it closely, you won't fall this morning. If you let it light your path, you won't stumble this morning. If you declare it, you'll have power this morning. If you speak it, you'll be comforted this morning. If you trust it, mountains will move out of your way. Hallelujah. Can I get a hallelujah this morning? That's God's word this morning. It's quick and it's powerful and it's sharper than any two-edged sword. Can I get a hallelujah this morning? Glory, glory, glory. Oh, mighty God, mighty God. Hey, I know where I'm going. Because I know God's word concerning my life this morning. So Jesus looks at the Pharisees and says in Matthew 9 and 13, now go and learn the meaning of this scripture. That's what he said. Now go and learn the meaning of this scripture. Now let's define the phrase, now go. So in the Greek, it means to move away from a place into a different place. So I'm challenging someone today to get a passion for what God, for what God's word says concerning you. You need to get it down in your spirit. My God, when Jesus said, now go, what he was saying was it's time to get in your lane. Like what I said, our message title today is, my God, it's time for lane change. My God, because we need to step into the faith zone. So what he was saying was, it's time to get in your lane. Get out of the lane of emotions. Get out of the lanes of opinions. Get out of the lane of judgment. Get in the lane of faith, in the fallible word of God. That's what he's saying to us this morning. That's what he's saying to you. Yes, you this morning, that he wants you to get out of the emotional whirlwind that you've been in. Get out of the lane of the opinions of others because you're letting others define you. Get out of the lane of judgment. You've been casting judgment on yourself. Then he says, get into the lane of faith in the infallible word of God. Yes, that's what he's saying to you. Too many swirls, too much going around and around and around. I call that you have gone around the mountain long enough. Now it's time to head north. In Deuteronomy 2 and verse 3, yes, it's time for you to turn. Get out of that lane you've been swirling far too long. It's like 285 in Atlanta. It's one big old circle. My God, you can get on that one end and you can keep driving around and around. But if you don't get off 25, you will think that you have transitioned to a different highway. But it's the same highway because it circled the entire perimeter of Atlanta. This morning, some of you have been on the same path, the same road consistently. And the Lord is saying, because emotions is trapped in there, opinions are in there, judgment is in there. But if you ever inject the lane of faith in there, which is the infallible word of God, my God, your life will be ordered and restructured. And there is no turning back. Yes, I get it. There will be times in your life and my life when you'll want to drift out of the lane of God's word. Yes, yes, yes. And get into the lanes of opinions and judgments and other things that are less than facts. But after you have an encounter, say encounter somebody. After you have had an encounter with Jesus, he sets you in the right lane. Oh, glory be to Yahweh this morning. But when you have an encounter with Jesus, he sets you in the right lane. Today he's saying to you, yes, you, yes, you, yes, you. Now, my beloved, you need to stay in that lane. Oh, glory be to Yahweh. You've been drifting far too long. He's saying, no, my beloved, you need to stay in that lane. I placed you in this lane and I need for you to stay in that lane. You need to always stay in the lane of faith in his words, in God's words this morning. Yes, 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 yes. Hallelujah. I didn't come here to give you no sugar-coated message this morning. Or no feel-good message this morning. I come to stir up your pot. I come to stir up your yard. I come to make waves in your life this morning. Because you've been swirling far too long. My God, you've been drifting far too long. And the Lord is saying, now, my beloved, you need to stay in my faith zone. You need to stay in the lane that I placed you this morning. Glory be to Yahweh. Because you need to have an encounter, and this is the day where the encounter happens. Mighty God, this is your aha, your watershed moment, where the realization has come that I shone my light upon you, mighty God of Zion. And because I shone my light upon you, my glory shall be seen. Hey, hallelujah, this morning. So there are about key things I want you to take away from today's message is persuasion to God's word. It's the first key point. Persuasion to God's word. In Acts 28, 23, and 24, it says, so a time was set, and on that day, a large number of people came to Paul's lodging. He explained and testified about the kingdom of God and tried to persuade them about Jesus from the scriptures. Using the laws of Moses and the book of the prophets, he spoke to them from morning until evening. Some were persuaded by the things he said, but others did not believe. Like the Jewish community of Rome that Paul spoke to. Some were persuaded by the things he said, but others did not believe. Does that sound familiar this morning? Some of us have not done great things because we're not persuaded we can. Let that hit home. Let it hit you like a ton of bricks this morning. Some of us have not done great things because we're not persuaded we can. You have not convinced your own self that you can. So that's why we haven't done great things. We say we believe. There's a word that comes out. Yeah. But inside, you're like, no, can't do that. Who am I? I'm the little girl from Getmore. Nobody even know that that place even exists. So how can I do that? So some of you have not done great things because you're not persuaded you can. You've not gone for that promotion because you don't think you can. And what did I say about thinking? It's an opinion. That's your opinion. But what did God say? Some of you have stayed in the same job because you don't think that you can go beyond that job. What does God say? But here is the ultimate question this morning. Are you persuaded that God's word has the power that it has? Are you persuaded that God's word has the power that it has? And if your answer is yes, if you are, then some of you are not acting like it. Because you're saying yes, but you're not acting like it. But this morning, I am convinced that something happened in Matthew when he met Jesus. Something happened in Matthew when he met Jesus. Just like how I'm convinced something happened to me when I had an encounter with Jesus. Glory be to Yahweh. I am convinced that when you meet Jesus, something will happen because you can't deny the encounter that you have with him. Glory be to Yahweh.
Hallelujah.
This word says, Matthew 9 and 9 says, as Jesus was walking along, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at his tax collector's booth. He said, follow me and be my disciple. Jesus said to him, so Matthew got up and followed him. Now, if you're reading, and reading is fundamental, I tell this to my children and I tell them to the people that report to me at work, I said, reading is fundamental. The word says, as Jesus was walking along, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at his tax collector's booth, at his booth, his tax collector booth, his place of employment. He said, follow me and be my disciple. That was the command Jesus said to him. And Matthew did what? So Matthew got up and followed him. So in simple terms, the Bible says that Matthew left everything. It didn't say Matthew Matthew heard the term, follow me and be my disciple, and then turned around and got all of his stuff together. The Bible didn't say that. It didn't say that. So many of us would like to say it's an inference that he probably got up his little bag and whatever. It said Matthew got up and followed him, meaning that he left everything behind. That's what the word said. So I'm not putting in Carleen's piece this morning. No. The command was given, follow me and be my disciple. That's what Jesus said. He gave a direct command to Matthew, and Matthew got up and followed him. So in terms of what is written, because reading is fundamental, the Bible says that Matthew left everything. That's what it said. He was willing to leave his position because he was persuaded to God's word. Hallelujah, my God. That's point number one. He was willing to leave his position as tax collector, because he was persuaded by God's word. Point number two, he was willing to leave his popularity among the powerful people because he was persuaded to God's word, to God's word. And point number three, he was willing to pursue the unknown, because he was persuaded to God's word. Again, I ask the question, are you fully persuaded in your own mind that God's word is true? God's word is facts. The word fully persuaded in the Greek language mean completely assured and most surely believe. This means that you know that you know that you know that God will carry out fully what he has spoken and had written down for you and me. Glory be to Yahweh. Hallelujah. This means that you know that you know that you know that God will carry out fully what he has spoken, what he has said concerning you, what he has written down for you and me. Oh my God, are you persuaded this morning? Hallelujah. Galatians 3 and 22 says, what the scriptures declare, that we're all prisoners of sin. So we receive God's promise of freedom only by believing in Jesus Christ. We receive God's promise of freedom only by believing in Jesus Christ. So understand, however, there is a big difference between confessed faith and demonstrated faith this morning. There is confessed faith and there is demonstrated faith. You will only stay in your lane to God's word and not succumb to the controls of emotions if you practice your faith. My God, this morning, if you're not practicing, my God, that's why you're veering to and fro. You're all over the map because you're not practicing your faith. You're not submitting yourself into the word of God. You're not persuaded to the word of God. My God, yes, yes, yes. If our churches have half the faith we claim we have, we would see the lame walk, the mute talk, and the dead jump out. We would see Lazarus hobbling out in grave clothes if we had half the faith that we claim we have. Your faith is only as good as the level of your demonstration this morning. What are you demonstrating? What are you saying this morning? My God, my God, my God. Your faith is only as good as the level of your demonstration. Hey, when the rubber meets the road, yes, all of that you've been shamashamaing about in the dark, but when your faith is tested, what is your level of demonstration of your faith this morning? Are you going to succumb to the controls of your emotions? Are you going to say, faith, that faith arise in me, my God, my God? As a proof point to what I'm saying, if you're in the market, you're vividly here, the Lord says, go pray for that woman or man that's limping over there. There is a subject over there that needs a touch. My God, you're vividly here, the Lord say to you, go pray for that woman or man with the limp. Are you going to wait for faith to grow? Are you? What's going to happen in that moment? Are you going to wait for your faith to grow and then do what he told you to do? Huh? Or you're going to do what he told you to do, then your faith will grow. What's happening today is that we're waiting for our faith to grow first. But the Bible says, faith is a substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not yet seen. I don't see it yet, but I'm trusting him for it. And that is what's happening today. Mighty God of Zion, is that we're waiting for faith to grow first and not do what he told us to do, then faith will grow. I just came up your street. We're waiting for our faith to grow and not do what he told us to do. And when you do what he told you to do, your faith will grow. Because he will show up and show out. Because you follow the instructions. Because when he gives a command, which is his word, he must complete it and he must perform it. When you take the step, the missing ingredient. Remember, he said his word, he honors his word above his name. So he told you to do. Don't wait for your faith to grow. Do what he told you to do, and then faith will grow. Point number two is perspective to God's plan. Matthew 9 and 10 and 11 have already read, but I want to remind you, it said later Matthew invited Jesus and his disciples to his home as dinner guests, along with many tax collectors and others, disreputable sinners. But when the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with such scum?" What choice of words? So it amazes me how subjective so many things are. One person sees something beautiful and another sees something ugly. But think about what an extremity the Pharisees got with the phrase and the sentence and choice of words. Why does your teacher eat with such scum? Because their perspective had them so much higher than everyone else that they couldn't see their own hearts. They couldn't see themselves. They thought themselves higher than everyone else. That's what that meant. They were looking down on others. But we need to get the perspective of God's plan for our lives. Isaiah 64 and 6 says, we are all infected and impure with sin. When we display our righteous deeds, they are nothing but filthy rags. That's what Isaiah 64 and 6 says. Like autumn leaves, we wither and fall, like we are in fall right now in the U.S. And our sins sweep us away like the wind, which means that the people Jesus was with were unworthy of being with Jesus. Neither were the Pharisees. Let me tell you. That's it. If the people Jesus was with were unworthy of being with Jesus, neither were the Pharisees. Sometimes our perspective needs adjustment. Yes, you need an adjustment. You need to be recalibrated. Some of us are stuck in one spot. And Christ is telling you, the Lord is telling you, it's time to move lanes so you can see what I'm truly doing. The truth of what Jesus was doing was already written. That's the truth of the matter. What was written in the scripture and what was done was already written, but they could not see it. Are you not seeing God's plan this morning? How often is God trying to show you something, but because of how you see, you can't see it? So as a result, this morning is time for a new perspective. So let's look at everything through the perspective of the cross. When you feel weak, 1 Corinthians 1 and 18 says, the message of the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction, but we who are being saved know it. It's the very power of God, my God. That's when you feel weak. 1 Corinthians 1 and 18 wrap you up. The message of the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction, but we who are being saved know it. It's the very power of God. When you feel such shame, you think you can't come back. Galatians 2 and 20 says, my old self has been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. So I live in his earthly body by trusting in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. When you feel unloved, think of Romans 5 verse 8. But God showed us his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. When you feel guilty, my God, Colossians 2 and 14 says, he canceled the record of the charges against us and took it away by nailing it to the cross. My God, who am I speaking to this morning? When you feel lifeless and hopeless, Philippians 3 and 10 through 11 says, I want to know Christ and experience the power that raised him from the dead. I want to suffer with him, sharing in his death, so that one day or another, I will experience the resurrection from the dead. My God, one of us, all of us fit in one of these buckets this morning. But I'm here to tell you that God's word still stands. God's word is powerful and it's quick and it's sharper than any two-edged sword. Have an encounter with him. Yes, point number three, there is pain in the change. Yes, if you're going through something, there is pain in the change. Matthew 9 and 12 says, when Jesus heard this, he said, healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do. And we all know that that's true. Healthy people don't need a doctor, but sick people do. So I want to underscore that God's word, it should change us. God's word changes us. If you stay the same despite it being declared over you, you're in the wrong lane. I want that to sit with you this morning. God's word changes us. But if you stay the same, despite it being declared over you, you are still in the wrong lane.
Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Mercy.
Oh, glory be to God. Know that comfort and change are enemies. I need somebody to put that in the chat room. Comfort and change are enemies. And they can never coexist together. I hope I'm speaking to someone this morning. Comfort and change are enemies. They're arch enemies. And they can never coexist together. So if you want to change, but you're still comfortable, my God, how can that be? Because they can't coexist together. One is going to overcome the other. Comfort is going to overcome change. Because comfort don't want to do anything new. Comfort don't want to change. I'm going to want to stay in the same position it had always been. They want to stay on the sofa. They don't want to get up. They want to stay in Lollipop, but they don't want to go to the palace. Do you understand this morning? But change is about to come. Isaiah 43 and 19 says, for I am about to do something new. The Lord says this morning, see, I have already begun. Do you not see it? I will make a pathway through the wilderness. I will create rivers in dry wasteland. Glory be to God.
Come on now. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Oh, glory, glory, glory. For I'm about to do something new. That's what Isaiah 43, 19 says. For I'm about to do something new. See, have already begun. Because the stirring is there. Hallelujah. Oh my God. Oh, you've been disturbed. It's there. I've already begun. Do you not see it? Mighty God of Zion, I will make a pathway through the wilderness. My God, I will create rivers in the dry wasteland. The prophet Isaiah proclaimed in Isaiah 43 and 19 that God will do a new thing in our lives. Yes, something we couldn't do ourselves. This thing will be impossible for man. But my God, this morning it's possible with God. My God, in impossible, I tell you, the word spells out for God. I am possible this morning. Glory be to Yahweh. Just know that those who do great things for God also struggled. Yes, 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 they struggled. Sometimes we think that those who made an impact in Christendom never struggled with anything. The difference this morning is those who do great things for God know how to put their feelings in check and behind their faith. I hope you heard that. The difference is those who do great things for God know how to put their feelings in check and behind their faith. When Jesus called Matthew, he did it in Matthew's booth. That's what the word of God said. He went right into Matthew's booth and called him. The booth represented Matthew's whole life, because his career defined him. So Jesus walked into Matthew's booth like he's walking into many of your lives today. My God of Zion, Jesus. Okay. Come into your booth, into your life, into your job, into your school, and change everything. And there will at times be pain in the change. Yes. But that's how you know you're in the lane of faith in his word, because there is pain in the change. Hallelujah. Someone needs to say today, I am not going to chase what is comfortable. I'm going to chase his command. I'm going to chase that real change that he's calling me up to level up to. My God of Zion, this morning, his intentions are never to hurt you are causing discomfort, but when you stay in the lane of God's word, your pride will take a beating, your desires will take a beating this morning. Are you ready for an encounter this morning? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready, my God, this morning? Because he said, see, I am doing a new thing. I have done it already. Don't you see it? I will make a path through the wilderness for you, where some are dying, you won't, because I will create rivers in the dry wasteland for you. Glory
be to God. Amen.
My last point today is purpose in the moment. Purpose in the moment. Matthew 19 and 13 says, now go and learn the meaning of the scriptures. I want you to show mercy, not offer sacrifices. For I have come to call not those who think they are righteous, but those who know they are sinners. When you pursue God, your God-given purpose, you will have no choice but to get out of the lane of emotions and get into the lane of God's word. You will have no choice. Those who do great things for God know how to put their feelings in check, like I said, and get behind faith. The Pharisees had feelings. Jesus had facts. The Pharisees had feelings, but Jesus had facts. You will need real instructions to pursue your purpose, and your emotions won't cut it. You hear that? Your emotions won't cut it. You will need real instructions to pursue your God-given purpose, and your emotions won't cut it. God, remember, your emotions are fickle. Your emotions, one minute you're one way, the next minute you're something else. Best believe that there are days that I get up to preach and I'm just not feeling it. I'm like, God, I don't know. But know that emotions will only allow you to do something great when you're feeling great. But let me repeat this. Know that emotions will only allow you to do something great when you're feeling great. But, when you are in the lane of faith in God's word, every moment is a moment to wake the dead. Hallelujah, my God of Zion. Hallelujah. Know that emotions will only allow you to do something great when you are feeling great. Because when you are down, oh my God, emotions will keep you down there. You're not at your best. But when you're in the lane of faith in God's word, every moment is a moment to wake the dead. And if you disbelieve, in Ezekiel 37, 1 through 5, the word of God said, and he said to me, son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, oh Lord God, you know. Then he said to me, prophesy over these bones and say to them, oh dry bones, hear the word of the Lord.
Amen.
Lord God, to those bones, behold, I will cause, my God, breath to enter you, and you shall live. That's what the Lord is saying. I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. You shall live. You shall live this morning. Yes, can these dry bones live? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Amen.
Sigh over these dry bones and say to them, oh, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. And the Lord says, my God, to these dry bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. We have come to a choice to stay in the lane, hallelujah, of where we're at, or to enter the lane of faith and hold that lane. Don't veer to the left, don't veer to the right, but hold your faith lane. This morning is what I'm telling somebody. Just hold your faith lane. We need to hold on to the word of God, because we're pursuing to God's word. Proverbs 4, 25 and 26. In the Amplified Bible says, which morning man have got a dose of this already. Let your eyes look right on with fixed purpose, and let your gaze be straight before you.
Hallelujah.
The path of your feet, and let all your ways be established. Oh. And ordered aright. Yes, yes, yes. It's time to switch lanes to the faith lane. Now go and learn the meaning of the scripture.
Does thank somebody you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. It's not enough to just be saved. Yes, I'm telling you that this morning. It's not enough.
Mercy.
To be saved. But be powerless to pursue the plan of God. 22, they also found video. Because some of us, we're just saved and we're powerless. Because we're not pursuing God this morning. We're not pursuing him this morning. We're not pursuing him this morning. It's not enough just to warm bench. It's not enough just to say that I got saved, but there is no fruit that's coming from you. Hallelujah. You are powerless by God, but when you get in the word, he will mount you up. He will lift you up. Hallelujah. He will switch you, hallelujah, out of the lane that you're in into his faith lane this morning. Glory be to Yahweh. I pray this morning that you got your dose. You had an encounter with him. It's time to change lanes. Hallelujah, this morning. It's time to change lanes this morning. It's time, it's time, it's time. Hallelujah. It's time to change lanes to the faith lane this morning. Glory be to Yahweh. Glory be to Yahweh. Glory be to Yahweh. Hallelujah. This morning, the word has been given. Hallelujah to each and every one this morning. The word has been given. The word has been given. Hallelujah. Won't you take heed today? Won't you take heed today? Won't you take heed today? Because the word of the Lord has been given. Take heed. Today is time to change lanes to the faith zone. Enter the faith zone. Follow me and be my disciple. What's the command that Matthew got? Are you going to follow him this morning and be his disciple? Are you going to follow him? And he's at it this morning. Now go and learn the meaning of this scripture. Learn who he is. Be persuaded to the word of God. Be persuaded that he can do all things. Be persuaded that he's behind you, in front of you, on top, beneath, everywhere you go, 360 degree protection. And he's saying, come on, change lanes. And I will show you great and mighty things. God bless you this morning. We here at Recharge, the Logos is in action. The word is in action. It's quick and it's powerful. And this morning, the Lord is saying to you, come on, and I will give you rest. Lay your yoke upon him. Whatever your fears are, whatever your trials are, whatever your doubts are, lay it upon him and he will give you rest this morning. There's an encounter that he wants to have with you. And when you have that encounter, you will never be the same. When you have that encounter, your lane changes and you step into the faith zone because you're persuaded to God's word. God bless you today. I thank you for joining Recharge Ministries. If there's anyone that needs for me to pray for you this morning, just raise your hand this morning. Slip your hand up with your emojis this morning and I will pray for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The word of God is quick. It's sure. Hallelujah. It's powerful. It brings the anointing that we need. When we're unsure, when we need clarity in how we move and where we go, the Lord is saying, but my word is already there for you. Thank you, Lord Almighty. This morning, Lord, I bring your people before you. They're your people because you are the author and the finisher of our faith. You are the El Shaddai, the God of plenty. You are more than enough. You are our sovereign God this morning. And we thank you, Lord, that We this morning are coming to you. You already know every trial. You already know what we're going through, Lord. But Lord God, we enter into your rest this morning. We enter into your pavilion this morning, God. We're coming before you, Lord God Almighty. I thank you, Lord God, this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord God Almighty. Touch the one that's hurting this morning. Touch the one that's mourning this morning. Because you're the God of the comfort this morning. You are the one that healeth thee, Almighty God. Hallelujah. This morning, a place, Lord God, Sister Carolyn, before you, Lord God, online, Lord God, her family is in mourning, Lord God Almighty. But I know a God who can. Hallelujah. I know a God who can. I know a God that specializes this morning. Hallelujah, when the tears are falling, I know a God that's wiping away every tear from the eye. I know a God that, oh Lord, you can hide and run into this morning. A God who you can lean on. A God who you can count on this morning. So Lord, I pray for your virtue, Lord. Hallelujah. Well, to touch her family this morning, Lord, and remind her, Lord God, of who she is and who she belongs to this morning. Because you are the great I am. Hallelujah. This morning. Hallelujah. You will comfort her weary heart today, Lord. I thank you, Lord God Almighty. We pray for, hallelujah, Sister Benin, this morning, Lord God Almighty, online, that's hearing your word, and your word touched her heart, oh God, this morning. Father God, touch her, mighty God. Touch her from the crown of her head to the sole of her feet, the Lord God Almighty. Because you are the God who can. You are the God who will. And you specialize in things that are impossible. Because you said, I am possible. This morning, I place a recharger before you. With their hands lifted high this morning. Lord God, mighty God of Zion. You will part the Red Sea for them, Lord God. Hallelujah, my God. You don't allow, oh God. My God, your people to suffer this morning. Mighty God, you will come to their aid. And Lord God Almighty, oh my God, we bring all, hallelujah, all our pain, our sorrows, our trials before you, because you are the God who can. You are the God who will. Try every tear. Touch every heart. Mend every broken heart today, Lord. Quiet every noise in the ear. Silence every noise, every negative voice in the ear. And let your voice come through with clarity. Let your voice come through with authority. Let your voice come through with a command that needs this body to quicken, for the soul to arise and take our seat inside. Father, I thank you this morning for your children that have stretched forth their hands this morning to say, Father, I give you access to my life. I give you access to do as you see fit today. Lord God, step on in. Step on in, Lord. And make the crooked path straight. Make the wavering come to a calm, because your word prevails. And we're persuaded by your word today. I give you thanks. I give you praise right now. I give you all the glory and all the honor for what you are about to do. For what you are about to do. For the hearts that will be mended. For the hearts that will be comforted. For the hearts that will be healed. For the hearts that will find a new path. And find new meaning in you. I give you thanks and I give you praise. I say amen and amen. God bless you, everybody.